Welcome to the Journal. I'm Darryl Wood. The road to stardom is rarely smooth, and for Gladys Knight, it was no exception. At the age of 8, she took the world by storm on Ted Mack's original Amateur Hour. At 16, after graduating high school, she found herself pregnant and married. In spite of her circumstances, she persevered. Gladys Knight went on to lead one of the top groups during the Motown era, and the rest is history. Coming up, we'll talk with the legendary Gladys Knight about her life, loves, and music, next on American Black Journal. Gladys Knight, thank you for joining us on this edition of the Journal.
My pleasure, anytime.
You have written that you are a glutton for life.
Yes, I am.
What does that mean?
That means bring it all on. See, we all are here to learn our lessons and basically to get back to Heavenly Father. Whether we all know that now or not is a horse of a different color, okay? But it's all of that. Everything that happens in this life and in this experience down here on earth that gets us there or makes us who we are, okay? And that's what I'm about. I'm about experiencing it all. And that's why the title for my book as well, Between Each Line of Pain and Glory, My Life Story. And there's no way that I could bring this book to you candidly without giving you the glory and the pain. And that's what I mean about life. It's the ups and downs, the challenges in our lives. What would life be, do you think? Listen, I'm asking you a question now. If it were not for those down things, it's the challenges in our lives that teaches us our lesson.
But sometimes people get tired.
Yeah.
And you've also said that as a young child, that's when you started out singing.
Yes.
Mama identified those talents that you had, those gifts.
Right.
And while she didn't force you to do anything, she always found ways for you to be involved in singing somewhere.
That's right.
Whether it was for a relative's birthday party or whether it was at school or church or whatever.
That's right. Because we need help to follow our dreams sometimes. That's why we need support systems, because they help us to recognize things that we wouldn't ordinarily see. Sometimes, I mean, I've been singing since I was 4. How would I know I'm supposed to sing at 4? I had no vision, but my mom and dad did, okay? And thank goodness they had vision. See, I was just making my mud pies at 4, see? And it was a whole nother ball game for me. And then as I grew up, I finally learned to appreciate this gift that Heavenly Father had given me, because I didn't even realize it as that in my early years, even though we were trained and brought up into the spiritual environment, that veil doesn't lift until we're all ready.
And have gone through some things. Which is certainly what you talk about in the book. You talk about many of the journeys and many of the roads down which you had to walk. Runs that you would rather not have gone down.
That's right.
But all of which have made you who you are today.
Exactly. I had some people who were just friends that, that had been knowing me for a while. And some members of my family were a little bit concerned about some of the things that I would talk about, like my gambling. And they, well, you know, is it really necessary that you talk about that? Because people have images of you when you are part of an industry as such as mine. And I feel like, yes, that's a necessary part of the story, because we all fall short of the mark occasionally. And that's what this book, in my opinion, this is what I wanted to say with the book, is that we can all make it. Mm-hmm. We can all get there. And we all have our little idiosyncrasies or our shortcomings. Here are a few of mine, because we cannot always point the finger at other people and say, well, you didn't do this or you didn't do that. And, ooh, they're doing all of this drinking and gambling and smoking and doing all. Well, here's some of mine, rather than address others. And here's how I dealt with it and try to come back.
But it was more than that. Mm-hmm. And by that, I'm saying that as we move through your life story, we look at a young girl who's thrust into the national spotlight.
Yes.
We look at a young girl who comes from a family with the hardest work ethic in Atlanta.
Yes.
Dad's a top flight employee with the post office.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, he was the first black postal employee in that area at the time.
I don't know if he was the first black, but he was certainly among the first to do that.
Hardworking man, took care of business, took care of his family. Mm-hmm. You had a strong-willed mother who did things her way.
Yes.
She tried to make things work at home with dad, but sometimes she went her own way.
That's right.
Add to that the fact that you grew up on, at least a part of the time, the streets where you chronicle some of your exploits out there.
Yes.
If you weren't making mud pies,
yes.
you were involved in fisticuffs on the street corner at a later time.
That's
so
right.
when you take a look at all these experiences and then you move on into adulthood and all the things that Gladys Knight has experienced, I had to say to myself, are there parts of your life, like singing, that you felt at some point were impositions upon you?
Not really. The only thing that, as you made a statement a while ago, you get tired. And we do. Mm-hmm. And as long as we realize that life is going to be tough, life is going to be rough, we can get on with the living of it. There's been a responsibility on my shoulder for a good portion of my life. Got married early, mm-hmm. was a mother early, was a wife early. The Pips and I, our group evolved after a while where I had a lot of the responsibility of the group because I evolved the lead singer, where we did not start out that way. So subsequently, as people adopted me and raised me up in this industry, it became a point there where they were saying, well, hey, if Gladys doesn't come, we're not interested in the group. I'm giving you realistic things now, okay? So I always had to be considerate of that fact that if I don't go to work, nobody goes to work. And that's the reality. And I was always cognizant that I needed to step up to the plate and really be responsible in that light. And it got kind of tough sometimes because there were times when I didn't want to go to work or I didn't need to go to work when we're talking about having four people involved. Those four people don't necessarily have to do everything the same way. We get our money and once it goes into those four individual pockets, it's up to the individual what they do with it. So if I save mine and put it over here for a rainy day, and I want to say in 3 months' time, well, I'm not going out because I don't need to work this month. I'm going to stay home with my kids who need me to be here for PTA. Then think about that decision that has to be made when there are so many others that didn't save and don't go to work.
To close out that thought, you said at an earlier point in your life, to God,
yes,
take it away from me.
Right.
I'm tired of this voice. I'm tired of the singing. Just
right.
take it.
Right.
What was that all about?
I am so glad he didn't hear me. That would have really been, when I think about it now, I just get nervous. I just want to break out of the cold sweat, see? Because,
what brought you to that moment?
Well, I'm a teenager. I lived most of the time, my mom saw to it that we kept our feet on the ground. All right, it wasn't about, oh, I'm Gladys Knight, who's that? You know, that just happened to be a name that people became familiar with. As far as my life is concerned, I sing. I make a living at singing, just like you make a living at doing what you do. And that's how my mom and dad and the family always kept us looking at it. But there still were responsibilities, disciplines. That's a good word. Disciplines you had to keep in order to be the best at what you could do. That's any profession. But we had to rehearse. And there were commitments we had to keep. I was working and going to high school. I also worked with a jazz band. So every weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, I'm from 10 to 2 with the jazz band. During the summer, I go out with the Pips, still having to keep up a school schedule. That was a lot. And so I didn't get a chance to date. And I didn't get a chance to go to the canteen every Friday night like my other girlfriends. Or I didn't get a chance to go down the street in the evening and skate. I either had homework or I had rehearsal. So you just get a little bit tired sometimes of being so disciplined. We all fall short of that mark sometimes. And so I just felt like, hey, you know, if it wasn't for the singing, maybe I could get more of that canteen in, you know, or I could get more of this in.
Or more athletics because you were an athlete.
Yes, you know.
And that went by the board because of the singing.
That's right. I was on the basketball team. I ran track. I was in the field. I didn't do none of it well, but, you know, I enjoyed doing it. And all of these things were just about being a normal teenager, so to speak. And we all want to identify. That's even today. It's that peer thing.
The teenage years ended, though, quickly. And as your mother had told you, when you become a parent,
yes, That's
exchange.
The end of it. That's right.
That's
my
the
mom
end of
didn't
it.
Play that. It wasn't about, you know, okay, so now you're going to have a baby. Okay, you give it to me and you go on being a teenager. My mama didn't play that.
Jimmy was your high school sweetheart.
Yes, he was.
He was, as you put it, your only pure love.
That's right.
And what does that mean?
Well, really, I mean, we grew up together, and we grew together, and he was brought up in the school, too, that if you are to be promiscuous, in those days, they used to call them shotguns. I don't care what they call them. It was still a responsibility for the consequences of getting someone pregnant. See, today, you got so many, you just lay down, you get up, the guy's over here, the girl's over there. We don't even deal with morality anymore. All right. So he was from that old school. OK. And he was the kind of guy to say, OK, well, you're pregnant now. But so we'll get married. And my thing was, I don't want to because my mom had given us a certain kind of independence. And there was a certain thing back in those days about trapping a young man. Women, even then, sometimes occasionally would get pregnant because they wanted the guy to marry. They knew what the code was. You know, if you get pregnant, he has to marry you, okay? But I never wanted to be like that. I always thought that marriage and love and all of those things were something different. And the only thing that kind of made me comply or come to the fore with that was we had been discussing marriage a long time before that, believe it or not, even at that young age. It seemed like we were so much older then at 16 and 17 and 19 and 20 than young people are today. Maybe it's just my mind. Maybe it's just in me. But that's what I saw. And even then, we talked about being married. And we didn't go steady like kids go steady today. They go steady today. They shack up. Mm-hmm. They, if that's a good word, I mean, we used to use living together, however you want to call it. You know, they leave home, and before you know it, they're sharing a place of dwelling. Let's just put it like that. No, we couldn't go there. It wasn't about that. But occasionally it was about having premarital sex. Mm-hmm.
Gladys Knight, we're going to take a break. And when we come back, we'll have more with the legendary Gladys Knight. And of course, you are watching American Black Journal.
Coming up, Gladys Knight speaks candidly about her love life, including her marriage to motivational speaker Les Brown.
In the middle of this divorce, I'm not yet a divorced woman. I'm not yet. But in the middle of all of this, I am higher spiritually than I've ever been in my life. And there was a reason that Les Brown came into my life.
This is Darryl Wood on the next American Black Journal. Author, preacher, and hip-hop intellectual Michael Eric Dyson joins me for a provocative look at hip-hop and its impact on American culture. Plus, Karen Clark Sheard of the legendary gospel group The Clark Sisters discusses hip-hop's influence on gospel music. As we rejoin our interview, Gladys Knight discusses her pregnancy and subsequent marriage at the age of 16.
We didn't go steady like kids go steady today. They go steady today, they shack up. They, if that's a good word, I mean, we used to use living together, however you want to call it. You know, they leave home and before you know it, they're sharing a place of dwelling. Let's just put it like that. No, we couldn't go there. It wasn't about that. But occasionally it was about having premarital sex. Mm-hmm.
And sometimes the consequence was the child.
Yes.
And what that meant was taking on all the responsibilities that went with it, which is what the two of you did.
Exactly.
That worked for a while. After a while, it got to be too much.
Mm-hmm.
Jimmy fell on hard times.
Mm-hmm.
Pursuing a music career was very important to him.
Yes, it was.
However,
and tough.
Other things pulled at him, just like today,
mm-hmm.
young people have other things pulling at them.
Yes.
Even though they know they should do the right thing, even though he knew there was another way to go,
mm-hmm.
there was a stronger pull.
Yeah.
Talk about that pull.
I think in a lot of lives, you know, a lot of things start down here. My daughter and I were just talking about it in the car on the way here to meet with you, and that we have to give our children the armor that they need early in their lives. Because if we're any kind of way close to knowing what the scripture says, the wicked's going to get wicker, and the spiritual are going to become more spiritual. So if you want them to go that way, you want them to walk in the light, you have to start right now. And there's so many things that affect our young lives coming up that we need to be cognizant of. Jimmy's mom died, my Jimmy, his mom died very young, and he always claimed, words are so powerful. Never forget this. I want to say this to your audience. Words are very powerful. He always claimed that he was going to die young, and he did. Whatever we claim for ourselves, okay, is usually the direction that we move in. And it was just those kinds of things. He never had that confidence in himself that he should have had. With all the brilliance, he was a brilliant musician, but he could not see it. And he didn't have that inner strength to tell himself, you know, I'm okay. I'm all right. And if you know Heavenly Father, the way you're supposed to know it, you know joy cometh in the morning.
Talking about the joy that comes mm-hmm. and expediting time, mm-hmm. you went through your episode with Jimmy. Mm-hmm. You had a beautiful son as a result.
Yes, I did.
You had a beautiful daughter.
Yes, I did.
As a result.
Kenya.
Uh-huh. And moving swiftly forward in time, uh-huh. you married again.
Yes, I did.
The most beautiful result, perhaps, of that marriage was
my son,
Shanga.
Yes.
Who is on his way to becoming a mogul, probably.
Yes,
as a restaurateur.
Yes, he is. He owns Gladys Knight and Ron Wine's Chicken and Waffles in Atlanta.
And looking at those two episodes mm-hmm. and your relationship with Les Brown, mm-hmm. your last husband, mm-hmm. what does Gladys Knight have to say to women and men?
I got a lot to say.
About life and marriage.
I have a lot to
relationships.
Say. Relationships. I think it's such a wonderful, positive state of being. It really is. Heavenly Father intended for us to have mates. Anything else is what's abnormal. Like, I've had people, even on the spiritual side, you know, and that was kind of disappointing to me, you know, say, well, hey, maybe marriage is not meant for you, you know. And I'm not saying that I'm out there saying, oh, I got to have a man. it's not about that. Matter of fact, I'm somewhere totally different with my spirituality right now. But if we walk in the light, we have so many promises that are made to us. Mm-hmm. He'll give us all the happiness, all the joy, the mate mm-hmm. that we're supposed to have in our lives and all of those things. So even with the three failed marriages, mm-hmm. the three failed relationships that I've had in my life, I've grown so much in the spirit. Mm-hmm. I would never at this point say, oh, no, I'm through with guys. No, I don't want that. I ain't gonna be married no more. It just don't work for me. Mm-hmm. Because I have not had the one that Heavenly Father sent for me. And all of the people that have come through my life at this point has brought me to this point. And if I say I'm not going to do it, then I'm running it again. Mm-hmm. And I want Heavenly Father to direct my life.
What you have emphasized mm-hmm. is that there is obviously a will and a purpose for your life that is higher than your own thoughts.
Oh, without a doubt.
You were saying near the end of the book mm-hmm. that you were going to write a fairy tale ending to this life story of yours, which now seemed to be in balance when the process server showed up at the door mm-hmm. and told you you were about to be a divorced woman again.
That's right.
What did you do to pull yourself together or keep yourself together at that moment?
I called on that faith that I've always called on. You know, even if I fall short of the mark, and we all do, you always got to be able to go back to that foundation to do what you know is solid. It's there. It's all there for us. To know exactly what to do in time of sorrow, if you're feeling guilty, if you're feeling angry, if you're feeling any of those emotions, there are things already planned out for you as to how you cope and how you deal with these things. You just go back to that and find it and get into it and say, hey, whatever your will is, let it be. And that's why in the middle of this divorce, I'm not yet a divorced woman. I'm not yet. But in the middle of all of this, I am higher spiritually than I've ever been in my life. And there was a reason mm-hmm. that Les Brown came into my life. What that is has not been revealed to me yet, mm-hmm. but I'm sure along the way it will be. It certainly will be. And I'm just so thankful for him, for the experience, everything in my life that has come through my life. I'm grateful for it. I wouldn't change a thing.
I'm not the kind of girl.
I wanted to ask you about your view of blacks in the entertainment industry and what you see as the relative lack of unity among performers today. Tell us about that.
I don't know if you should open this book or this can of worms or not, because it's something that's so close to my heart. That's another reason that I wrote this book, is to open up channels, let the young performer know who I am. Because we have to create a new base, a new foundation. There is no networking happening as far as the African-American young performer is concerned. Matter of fact, they're killing off each other. Literally killing off each other. It makes my heart sad. It's almost a divide and conquer situation going on here. And we have so much information, those of us who have come before them, to share with them, to keep them from making the same mistakes or from having to reinvent the wheel, that we could be sharing if we only had that open platform to get to them. Money has been, that dollar has been the guiding force or that bottom line decision maker for whatever they've been doing lately. The record companies have said, hey, don't come here unless you got a hit record. So they've been forced to reinvent the recording industry and to be out there on their own. I had an opportunity to talk with Tupac Shakur for about 3 hours in my dressing room in Las Vegas before he died. And it was amazing some of the things that were revealed that I had my own thoughts about them as rappers and their conduct as well before I got a chance to meet him. And it just pointed up so vividly the need for us to network among these African-American young performers, because all they're really doing sometimes is reaching out to us for help, for guidance. And neither one of us knows how to get to each other. There's a song in there somewhere, okay? And that's a sad, sad thing. And it started me on the road. Now when I get an opportunity to say something to them or have a forum as you're presenting me right now to say something about them, I try to use that forum positively to let them know that we have a problem here and they're not doing things correctly. They're not representing themselves or us the way we all need to be represented.
So how do we turn it around? How do we change it? How do we become as great as we need to be?
We must start getting to those people in that arena, the younger arena, that can make the difference. I saw an interview with Puff Daddy, Sean, the other day, and he's very well spoken. He is very intellectual, and he has an idea. He has his own idea of where they should be. And they're somewhere close to what we would have them be. But we need to connect up with them to let them know, hey, you know what? You're right about that. Hey, you know what? You're doing a good job. Hey, you know what? You guys are making great music. You just need to flip this around a little bit, right? If you don't want to be known for that, you need to get rid of that. If you don't want the drugs in your environment, you need to stop taking them or tell that guy, whoever's bringing them to you, no, we can't have that. And they need support in order to accomplish these things. That's, in my opinion, what's going to make the difference.
Gladys Knight, thank you so much for being with us. There's so much more we could have talked about, but we just don't have the time.
I've loved this. Thank you, Darryl.
Thank you. And thank you for watching American Black Journal.
Attention ABJ viewers, here's a chance to win a package of 4 tickets to see the holiday classic, The Nutcracker. The Detroit Symphony Orchestra presents this spectacular ballet at the Detroit Opera House. Be one of the first 2 callers at 313-876-8394, and we will give you 4 tickets for the Friday, December 19th, 8 p.m. performance of The Nutcracker. Speak clearly. Leave your name and a daytime phone number. If you are one of the first 2 callers at 313-876-8394, we will call you back. Furnishings supplied by Englander's Other Place, stores in Royal Oak and Ann Arbor. Production support for American Black Journal provided by Perfect Copies of Detroit.